afternoon, everybody, or good evening, whatever the case is. I think it's going to get really hot here, so I think Prashant had a great suggestion that you shouldn't have thrown your plates. They'll come in handy as fans, so be prepared for it. So before we get started, let me just kind of understand a little bit of the audience here. How many of you are actually doing a startup today? Wow. This is full-time startup, not wanting to do one, right? Okay. How many of your startups are already shipping products? Okay. And how many of those who are shipping are making money? Okay, very good. All right. So, we have also in the back, I saw Prashant, who is one of the TiE charter members. And he also runs the TiE LaunchPad and a great entrepreneur himself. And I'm sure he'll have a lot of wisdom to share. I'll ping him from time to time. And Shamdas, where is he? So here's another charter member. And he's an inspiration to all of us because at the age where he is, he still wants to start a new company. So, you know, great job, Sham. Keep it up. Okay. I think basically this is going to be a three-part talk. And I would say that if you haven't signed up for all three parts, you're probably not going to get the full value out of it. So I would recommend make sure that you can attend all three. Even though there is a published schedule of what is covered in each session, I'll probably overlap and change things around. Because as I started developing the slides, I felt something was not right, so it got changed. So what are we going to talk about? Let me just... Okay, that was not good. Okay. So the way we're going to do this is part one, which is today. We're going to talk about product management. We're going to talk about how to get the right product built. Why is that important? What you should think about, and so on and so forth. And I would encourage you to ask questions, but hold your questions until I'll allocate a time for question and answers. But if there is something really burning and you can't just live without and you have to ask the question there and then, feel free to do so. But just raise your hand, don't interrupt me, please. Part two, we're going to talk about how do you do your initial sales? What does it take? I'm assuming most of you are engineers. Are there any people here who are not engineers? Okay, minority, but there are some. That's good. And then part three is once you have gotten a product market fit, how do you really scale your marketing and sales? And this is all assuming you don't have a whole lot of money. I'm always going to make the assumption that you don't have a whole lot of money. When you have a lot of money, you will have 10 other ways to spend the money, so we'll not talk about that today. We'll focus on how do you do it in a bootstrap mode where you have a very little amount of money raised, if at all, and then how do you really take the business forward, okay? So let's talk about the first part. Why are we here? You know, everybody says you build it and they'll come. That was the old theory. Doesn't work. Noise level is very, very high. And by the way, you can all get access to these presentations as well as a video later on. So if you don't, you know, if you want to concentrate on, you know, listening and asking questions, that's better for you. That's how I get my inspiration from you, whether you're really getting what I'm trying to say. Okay. So this was a great slide I sort of picked up somewhere. I was doing a research and it says, okay, build it and they'll come, but who are they? If they know about it, is the price right? There when they need it, is it something they really need? These are the questions we'll answer today. How do you make sure about your product you can answer these questions? So what's a startup? Startup, in my mind, is three-part passion, two-part perseverance, and one-part practicality. And each of these three parts are very important. If you have only passion and no practicality, you'll probably build something nobody cares about. If you have too much practicality and no passion, your startup will be like, eh, nobody cares either. So it's like a unique mixture of these three things that really make a startup. And it's the initial part of it, the passion really comes from the founders. People who have this idea to change something. They look at something and say, this is not right. I think there is a better way to do it. And I'm going to do that. And I always say, okay, so I meet some entrepreneur and they'll say, I have an idea a day, a minute, every day I have a new idea. And I get passionate about each of them. How do I decide? First of all, you're not passionate if you have, every day a new idea. But there are people who are very creative, who will get lots and lots of ideas. And in fact, I keep a book of ideas. I probably have 40 written over the last few years, and I never sometimes get time to go over them, but sometimes I go and take a look at them. But an idea that you can sleep after and it is still fresh in your mind and it continues to bother you after you slept for a few days, it's probably the idea that is now asking for your attention. If it's an idea that came one day and you kind of forgot about it, it wasn't really important, probably it wasn't meant to be. And usually a passion is about something where you will say, why am I doing it? If your goal is, I'm doing it because I want to make money, probably you're not going to succeed very much. Your goal should be, why am I doing it? What is it that I'm going to change in the end by my action? Money will follow. It usually does if your idea is successful. But your idea is not going to be successful if you haven't done the first thing right. So, just because we're in Silicon Valley and it is very sexy to do a startup and you feel compelled to do a startup, don't. Do a startup for a reason. The reason is inside in your gut, which is telling you, hey, this is something I think I should change. This is something I want to make a difference in. So if you don't have that, go revisit your idea. Okay, so I've been looking at startups. I'm on my fifth startup. I've had some successes, I've had some failures, and I'm involved with lots of other startups with various folks. So I've been asking this question in trying to analyze, and this is something where once I find the time, I'll probably put even more time into it, but I have a theory. And the theory is there are three kinds of startups. The first kind of startup, I call it insurance startups. And what do I mean by an insurance startup? This is a startup that is focusing on security, compliance, things that you know as a company you cannot live without. You don't have a choice. And those are the companies that are, that are created because of certain regulations or some other reasons, or there are bad guys that need to be taken care of, and so on. And generally, insurance startups are much easier to get started. Why? Because the buyer buys your product because of CYA. They don't buy it because they think you have the best product. I mean, you don't buy insurance because you think you're going to die tomorrow. It's just for the peace of mind. You buy it, just in case. And that's why 90% of the insurance products are bought. In fact, many of them may never actually get used. However, most of the insurance startups, in my experience, are very difficult to scale. Because they're really a feature at the end of the day. Because you just found a new trap, you come in, you're able to get inside a company, but then you don't have a vision to expand it. There are a few exceptions, obviously. There are a lot of successful insurance companies like, Palo Alto Networks, FireEye, Mobile Iron, and there are probably many, many others. So there are successes out there, but it is harder to scale those. The second type of startup is what I call cost savings. Companies that allow you to cost save. And probably that is where the majority of B2B startups are. Somebody will save me 10%, 20%, 10 times, 4 times, 40x, 20x, 30x. There's no limit. And those startups really have a tough time. Why do they have a tough time? Unless and until those startups don't change anything in the way I was doing it, they have a tougher time. Why? Because the cost of sales is highest. Because the customer is not in a hurry. You may be in a hurry. Customer is in a CYA mode. They don't have a hurry to do this, unless and until there is a reason for them to go hurry up. Yeah, you save some costs, but you know what? I'm used to doing something that always works. I'm not changing. So you have a very long cycle to prove and prove and prove and prove. I mean, storage companies, there are hundreds of them. I don't know any one of them has any value add above and beyond this. Some of them succeed, for sure, in a big way. But their cost of sales are always higher. You can take a look at their cost of sales as a percentage compared to other companies, it will always be higher than most others. Again, like I said, I have not gone through every possible example, but this is the research that I intend to do one of these days with specific examples as well. So the third type of companies are the ones which I call, they generate new revenue opportunities for their customers. Now, what does new revenue mean? It doesn't necessarily mean money only. You know, Facebook didn't generate new revenue for us, but it generated new social currency that we didn't really have. That was something new. We didn't know that at that time, that that is something we all wanted. There are many companies that come in who disrupt a market the way it is going, where a market is kind of in a sleepy mode, doing the same thing over and over again, and they come in and disrupt this completely. So sometimes you may not create revenue opportunities, but you will destroy the revenue opportunities of incumbent players in a big, big way, which in my mind is in the same category. And you can see, you know, Uber is an example, classical example that we all know. Facebook is another good example. Airbnb is another example, which are more clear in the consumer space. We'll talk about the B2B space, but I think the issue really they hit is they have created revenue opportunity for somebody who didn't think that there was a revenue in it for them. So when you do that, what happens is people whose livelihood you affect, no matter what happens, they're going to defend you like hell. Unless or until you really totally screw up. And that is what you need. You need followers, the true followers, not ones who just go on Facebook and say yay, ones who really love you. Ones who really love your product because it affects their livelihood. Why was Microsoft so successful for so many years? Because they built a dependence. So many people got jobs working on supporting Microsoft products. I know these days it is very sexy to say every product in the enterprise should be really very easy to use. And yes, we are in that new world. But my guess is Microsoft and other big companies intentionally kept their products very complex. That's why there were so many companies built trying to put service revenue around them, and all of a sudden they were their champions. I mean, I went to a Microsoft SQL conference, I was amazed at the number of people who have been coming there for 20 plus years. Every year, without fail, they come to pay $5,000 to listen to the crap of a company, which is a commercial that they should be paying them. But instead, they pay $5,000 to listen to what this company is going to do and how their products are broken and how it can be fixed. That is the power of giving people something of an employment or some new revenue that they didn't think they had. So that's what you should think about your product when you do. Those are the products that will have initially maybe a difficult time once they get adopted. It's a rocket ship, okay? So this is just the detail of it. I won't bother with it. So let's talk about, you're going to build a product. And these are the three questions you should be able to answer. If at the end of the day today, you walk out and you understand that these are the three things I should have in my product, and if you can answer that very succinctly, then I think today's lecture will be successful. And that is the three W's. Who is my customer? We'll talk about that in detail. What do you do? And why you? Why now? If you can answer these three questions in a succinct manner, you will be successful. As a starting point, obviously. After that, it's all about execution. So let's talk about who is my customer. Now, who's a customer for Facebook? Anybody?
Companies who advertise.
No.
But they didn't bother about them at all in the beginning.
No, that's normal people. People.
You and I, everybody in this room, right?
Yeah.
If they continue to annoy us and continue to make advertisers happy, do you think they'll go anywhere?
New generation may, but it will take time.
They're already losing new generation,
right?
Right. That's already gone. They're now in the old generation. All of us in this room. Sorry for people who feel they're very young, but I took them out of this list. But anyway, so I think it is important for you to understand who your customer really is. Who are you really building for? Facebook always thought they were building for an end customer. They never thought they were building for an advertiser. Google never built for an advertiser. Not in the beginning. Do you know what Google's web page looks like today? It actually looked the same almost, just uglier version of it. There was not much change. It was a search bar. What are you looking for? That's all. All the other things they put on their website today, that's just new, but that thing hasn't changed. Because their customer in their mind was somebody who is searching information on the web, which was almost everybody. Because their goal is to organize the world's information. So I think it is really, really important you understand who is the buyer, who is the customer, and who is the influencer in your sale. Now, I'll give you an example that actually, maybe you're doing a development tool. Your buyer is probably the developer, you think, but developer has no budget. You want to charge, let's say your product costs $5,000 a month. No developer in any organization has that kind of a budget to go and approve. So the buyer may be the software manager, maybe the CIO, depending on the size of the company. But now there are two ways your sale will happen. Either you will go through the developer, make the developer happy, and hope he or she now goes up to their manager and tries to get an approval. That's one way of doing the sale. And there are many companies who have tried that and done it very successfully. And then the other way is to come from top down, meaning let me go focus on the manager. And then the manager is going to come back to the employee working for them and say, hey, what do you think of this product? And then there may be somebody else in the cycle as well, maybe the IT guy who gets affected by it. So that's your influencer in a way. Even if that IT person cannot make your sale happen, he or she can block your sale. Could say, not compliant with the company standard. Done. you finished. So the first and foremost, you need to think about who is my buyer, who is my influencer, and who is my user. You build the product for the user, you may build the message not for the user, but for the buyer. Your selling might be focused on the buyer. Depends on the product. Depends on how much you charge for the product. If I'm charging 10 bucks a month, probably every developer can go and click a card and maybe get an approval from their manager. Now I don't need to go to the manager. I'm only focusing on the developer. And we'll take some examples a little bit later on, but you know, the two companies that come to mind. Everybody knows Dropbox and Box. So here are two stories of contrast. Dropbox went after everybody, and now is trying to upsell to the enterprise, hoping that the users that bought their product inside the companies will go up and basically sell to their managers. And Box took a very different strategy. They said, no, I'm going to go after the manager who, I'm going to go directly after the IT. I'm going to go after the IT person who has a budget. And I'll make sure that my product is as good from a user point of view that every user is happy with it. And I'll make the sale. And I think, I don't know Dropbox numbers, but Box has certainly made a lot of progress as far as going after a Fortune 1000 companies. I mean, they have a billboard somewhere which says they do 99% of Fortune 1000 companies, and one being Microsoft, which will never buy their product. They'll probably buy the company, but not the product. So I don't know how true that is, but the point being, they've achieved a milestone because they came from a different direction. So I'm not suggesting one direction is better than the other. You got to understand what direction you want to choose. And every direction, you have to map out your plan and say, what is going to come in my way? Now, Box spent a lot of money because when Box came in, it was a new thing. They were disrupting something. Today, it's a commodity. Today, they are in a, you know, cost-saving sort of a mode where they are stuck in. So as a result, their cost of sales are high. However, when you do that at a later stage, when you already have the customers, it's much easier to spend that money. In the early stages, you probably don't have that much money to spend. Most companies don't. Exceptions exist, but I won't plan for that. So we'll have Vic here as one of our guests later on, and he made a very interesting comment that I want to repeat even before Vic comes on, and that is, he says, one of the things that he finds is that in the Valley, we all have this disease called investors. We always think, if I could get the money, I could change the world. You know what, I only need to raise 100,000. I only need to raise 500,000, and then I can make a big difference. And we keep chasing that. And then I keep hearing this, oh, you know, so-and-so raised $30 million. I'm doing exactly that. Even my product is a little bit better than them. I should be able to get some money. Wrong. Focus on your customers. If you got customers, which is called traction in the industry, investors will follow you. So if you don't have customers, you can have the best investors in the world, you will fail. I don't care what anybody thinks. That is a fact. First and foremost, focus on getting customers. Okay, so let's talk about still building the product. You know, you have to pick your market segments, right? Do you want to focus on SMB market? Do you want to focus on a large IT market? And that's what's going to decide what price you're going to charge for your product. And it doesn't mean what you're going to start with is where you're going to end. Salesforce started out for SMB. They were like $20. You know, you click your card and you're in business. But it's not the case anymore. Now they do $1 million deals every day. So I think one of the things I want you to understand, which is very, very important, I think, I don't remember who, but I think the founder of House made the statement in one of the lectures I attended. He says that Silicon Valley has a lot of amnesia. When you sit down with the founder of some very successful company, he'll tell you that he had the grandiose vision day one, and you know, he knew everything there is, but none of that is fact. You don't know everything on day one. Nobody does. We learn from our mistakes. People who learn very quickly go further and adapt and change, adapt and change. That's what it takes. Everybody does mistakes, whether it is your first time, second time, third time, fourth time, you just do different mistakes. So if you, and you know, you will see, in fact, there is a website I came across which actually has the first websites of most of these successful brands. And if you look at those websites, you will never buy from them. But it did happen. Maybe different times, but it is something to know. Now, many times I hear, you know, who's your customer? SMB. Sorry, that's not a customer. You gotta go deeper. You gotta tell me, what is the title of this guy who's your buyer? What is the title of this guy who's your user? So this is a cartoon from Tom Fishburne, who does some excellent cartoons in business. And he says, is it Swiss Army knife in the middle, and it says, our new brand delivers something for everyone without really doing much for anyone. And that is what a startup which is mainly focused on engineering ends up doing. So don't do that mistake. I'm an engineer, even though I call myself ex-engineer now because I have a degree, but I don't code. But I think the issue to understand it is, we engineers like to build things. And therefore, if nobody stops us, we'll keep on building and keep on adding features, keep on adding features, and that's not what the market needs. We'll talk more about it in a few minutes, but that's just a food for thought. So when you look at a customer, you've got to find the narrowest possible segment you are going to service first. Okay? Don't try to service the whole market. You will fail. Because you cannot. Some people get lucky, but leave that behind. If you are one of those lucky ones, great. But let's not worry about that. Don't try to build it for everyone. Figure out, is it an IT administrator you're working for, building for? Are you building for a customer in a certain particular market? Whatever that is. Identify, segment, make that segment as narrow as possible. Now, I'm not suggesting give the same message to the investor. So understand this. For what investors invest in is a vision. However, as a company founder and the early employee, what you are going to succeed in is execution. Execution has to be very narrow as possible, because you don't have resources. You have very few hours in the day, the 24 that you were given. And out of that, you need to sleep and do other things. So even if you are a Superman, there's only so many things you can do. So the trick is in trying to figure out what not to do. You can do many things, but figuring it out what not to do is as important as figuring out what to do. Okay. So this is a chart as an example I put for you. It is in. It was in. You know, one of the VC slides, which I thought was really good. I always keep this as a remembrance because somebody did a very, very good job. And that is the total addressable market, they said, is, So if you look at this, the total market is 341, but we are only going to focus on affiliates. And out of affiliates, we are only going to focus on this network payout. The point being, somebody actually exhibited to the investor, number one, they understand the market. Number two, they have segmented it very well. And number three, they know who are they going after. So when you go and tell an investor that I'm going after, you know, everybody, billions of dollars of market, nobody is going to believe you. If you believe yourself, sorry, it's not true. Nobody does that day one. So in the initial stages, focus, focus, focus. Focus is what is going to get you far. Okay? And like I said, learn to segment it better. So where do you start? Figure out the one thing that you are going to be best at. What is that one thing that you know none of your competitors can do as good as you do? What is that one thing you should be able to tell me? Even in your sleep, you should say, yes, and this is one thing I'll make sure no competitor can do better than me. So let's talk about, you've heard this word MVP, right? Does everybody know what MVP stands for? Minimum viable product, okay? So this is a great Dilbert cartoon. It says your user requirements include 400 features. Do you realize that no human would be able to use a product with that level of complexity? Good point. I'd better add easy to use to the list. So the moral of the story here is very simple. First, reduce the features. Remember, no engineering disease. Every time I put three engineers in a room and you come back after a few hours, there are a couple of features added. No. Your job as a product management person should be to say why a certain feature should exist or why it shouldn't exist. So it's more a job of elimination than of addition. Yes, you will add features as time goes on. You will add lots and lots of features for lots and lots of customers. But in the beginning, you need to find that hill you are going to conquer. Think of it as you have to capture this hill and be the king of that hill. On that hill, you don't need every possible feature under the earth. Now, there are some functional features that are going to be needed in products, right? If you're going to build a car, you know, Tesla couldn't have built a car and not put the steering and, you know, brakes and tires, right? It was needed. So there is a basic minimum feature set that is needed. And then you have to figure out, how do I have that aha moment, that delight for my customer? What is that one feature that they'll say, oh, wow, I got it. Or I love that part. What is that? I don't know. Depends on your users. What is one thing when you do Facebook, first time when you use a Facebook, what gets you hooked? You remember your first time you went on Facebook? Anybody? Absolutely. Immediately you see people you know. So actually, as listening to a talk by one of the early Facebook guys, and he said most of their time for years and years was fixated on how do I make sure that you have that aha moment right? Because as soon as you saw your friends on there, Now you're not going anywhere. And they saw people who didn't have many friends on Facebook really didn't come back. So every product has that aha moment. You got to create that aha moment to be perfect. So that when I use that product, I get that feeling instantly. Whatever you told me was the best feature of your product, it is visible to me. I get it. That's the key to making it happen. Okay? So let's talk about, there are three things that are, there are three ways in this market. You know, in B2B business, we're going to be dealing with elephants, right? So whether you like it or not, market has many elephants. But generally in any market, maybe one or two, you know, if you're doing, say, something to do with, you know, CRM, who are going to be the elephants? Salesforce and Microsoft maybe, and Oracle, okay. So now, understand there are elephants in the market. So you can do one of three things when you build your product, when you think about your product. This is one strategy you can do. Come in front of the elephant, and you know, if you want to survive, you'll have to constantly run and make sure your lead is at least 2 years, because elephant will announce something and customers will hold. So you can't, unless and until you brought something really, really unique. There are companies that have survived that approach, but not for very long. It's a very difficult strategy to survive on. Definitely not for startups. What's the other part? Have you ever seen an elephant walk? Has anybody seen an elephant walk? Come on, coming from India, you haven't seen that? Okay, when an elephant walks, there is so much room in between the elephant's legs. So if you figure out, if you are a little animal underneath it, you can probably survive forever, almost, until you start to become big. So that's called finding a niche. You're working on, you know, you are in the same ecosystem of Salesforce, but you're going to work on something which is not quite using their infrastructure, but you know, you are doing something where there is something missing in their product that you bring it up, or some niche that is relevant today. However, that's still a hard strategy, because elephant doesn't know. Big legs, don't know when it may end up crushing you, not even know you existed there, right? So what's the third strategy? This one. How many of you have taken a ride on the elephant? That's it? Oh my God. You guys should go back, when you go back to India, go take a ride. Because it is really important as a startup to have that ride. Why? Because you will experience that ride is bumpy. Like up and down, you don't know when you will fall. But that's the safest place you can be. Because if you are underneath, you'll get crushed. If you're in the front, be run over. So think of who your elephant is. Figure out a way to ride on top of the elephant. Don't fight it. That's the safest place around. In the beginning, that is the best strategy to do. Many companies have adopted that and succeeded a long time. That doesn't mean long term you're always going to be dependent on the elephant necessarily. Elephant becomes your enemy later on too. Yahoo and Google, classical example. Google rode on top of Yahoo because Yahoo used to resell Google. World turned around, right? So it's possible. So my point is, when you are doing your product, think about all the things in terms of the competition, where you are going to lie, who are you really going to compete with? Don't try to compete with a big guy. You're not going to succeed. Instead, figure out how to leverage the elephant in your business. One thing that I'm really amazed at, that how many entrepreneurs don't even take advantage of what I call free resources that big companies provide to you. How many of you are doing a product and not use any single Microsoft product? You don't use Office ever? You do, right? Now, how many of you signed up with the free Microsoft developer tools? Just three or four of you. And you know, it's the easiest thing. Saves you $5,000 right away. Figure out how to leverage it. Go on their website. They have a program, BizSpark. I think TiE used to be part of that at one time. If not, you can always find five other places to sign up for BizSpark. Google similarly has something. You know, you sign up with Microsoft, you can get $5,000 Azure credit. Why pay Amazon? How many of you pay Amazon for hosting? That's it? Come on, more people you said doing startups. I would expect every one of you paying that, right? So in the beginning, you don't need to pay, if that's easier. Then go sign up with Azure. The point I'm trying to tell you is there are ways to save money sometimes. But we seem to be caught in our ways and we think, oh, okay, Microsoft bad, I don't need to go there. No, no, no. As a startup, you need to figure out where else can I get some free money. That's called free money. Try to get it from any place you want. The second thing as a startup you're gonna need the most of.
Can we get Prashant to say something about Amazon Web Services and the TiE LaunchPad?
Sure.
I think that's included in there.
Yeah, so as part of our LaunchPad program, we do have AWS credits as well. And I'm sure Vic will bring this up in his talk, but the other thing is that TiEcon, we always run this TiE 50 contest. And Vic's company, Apakau, one of the TiE 50 winners, as part of that, they got $120,000 credit from IBM.
There you go.
So that's a double. I mean, for free Amazon, I think that's also $100,000 or so.
I forgot the amount, but yeah.
Yeah, so that's $200,000 as a startup that doesn't go on your cap table.
And you don't have to say it to somebody, my gross margin is 60% on a software product, right? Because an average machine on Amazon is going to cost you $20, and if you're doing a dedicated machine, if you're doing an IaaS-based product, you're going to spend, you may get $50 from your early customer, so you are at a 60% gross margin, and that's not a good cap table to have. So think about it. So I think the bottom line is, so that's one aspect. The second aspect of using an elephant is, every elephant has marketing programs. You are nobody in the market, let's be very clear. When you start as a startup, you need friends. You need any place and every place where you can get a referral. So you want your name on every possible place. Therefore, if you signed up with Microsoft program, with Amazon program, with whatever, and you have an entry in each one of them, maybe you'll get a link out of those. Remember, SEO is about building reliable links, amongst other things. So try to get those reliable links. Those are the ones that are your friends. And it doesn't cost a whole lot in the grand scheme of things. But those are cheaper. However, I want to make sure you prioritize this. Because again, like I said, you feel you have infinite hours. You don't. Because there are probably two or three of you or four of you and you have only budget for that many people. So you got to figure out how to leverage the time. Time is the resource, that the only resource you have that you need to plan by. Okay? So, some other commandments. I think, like I said, you've got to go to your customer. But the mistake that a lot of times startups tend to do is they want their customers to design the product. If their customers could design their product, they will be doing that themselves. They won't be working at those companies. So first and foremost, you need to know what you're building. You use your customers for feedback to understand what are their problems. If their problems that are top five problems of theirs, if you are solving one of those problems, you will get a call back. Otherwise, nobody will care about you. If your problems that you are solving don't fit in the priorities that they have been given this year, you're done. So try to understand that aspect better first. Then trying to say, okay, should I add this feature for you? No. That's later. Let's talk about that in the next talk. We'll talk about it next week about that. But I think the key really here for you, which is really, really important, is get closer to your customer so that your customer confides in you and tells you the problem he or she has, so you can see whether your solution really can solve that or not. But don't let your customer design your product. Okay? The second thing here I have here is customize with a cross. I couldn't get a better graphic, but that graphic I thought. So a lot of times, you know, as startups, some of us start with a product company and end up becoming a service company. And maybe it's not a bad thing. If that's what you want to do, it's perfectly okay. And in the beginning, startups do all kinds of things. You will do some services, fine. So long as you're doing services around your product. But don't try to create a product for every customer you run into. That is a bad strategy. It will get you nowhere. Even though 90% of the problems that customers want solved are similar, but if you continue to do that 10% for every customer, you will never be able to bring the bacon home. So think about it. You don't want to be a service company. You want to be still a product company. So yes, you help them deployment of your products or whatever it takes and charge them. Don't do it for free. There's no need to. But at the same time, don't do it in such a way that you become like a custom shop, so that when you go and start talking to investors for the next round, they say, oh, most of your revenue is custom. I'm not interested. Okay? So one more. I think Dilbert said it best. And that is, if everyone exposed to a product likes it, the product will not succeed. Now, I know it's contradictory. It's counterintuitive. If everybody in this room likes your product, it will not succeed. You know, it's called a Facebook like, right? Does any of the Facebook like is a buyer? No. You want people to love your product. It's better to have few people to love your product than to have many to like your product. Because people who like your product, they don't buy. And even if they buy, they don't talk to others about it. So you get no value out of that sale. As an initial startup, you are looking for value from each sale to multiply. So spend more time in making sure that whichever segment you designed it for, or whatever segment ended up liking your product, is not liking, but actually loving it. Okay? Everybody pivots after you listen to your customers. Some pivot 360 degrees, some pivot 60 degrees, some pivot 50 degrees, but nobody starts with one thing and always ends with that. So there is no shame in pivoting. But you have to know why you are doing it, and if the next one is actually any better than where you came from, because you may be solving the wrong problem every time. So it's important, when you have your product, find out which of your customers love it. That is the key to your success. So if you have nobody who loves your product, you are in deep blue. Okay, can somebody come here? What time is it, Adam?
5:08.
5:08, okay. Can I have you just do a little bit slides for me? Just click on these. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna have you take a look at a couple of sites, just so that you understand how they position it and see if you get some of what they're trying to do or not. There are some good examples and some bad examples. So first of all, we're gonna talk about the first four companies, they're competitors of each other, right? Let's see what their messages are. So we're just gonna go through this. So just go a little bit down. Just keep reading it, keep going down. Okay, stop. So what do you think this company does? Who's their customer?
Corporate.
Okay. And what do they do? Now you know it, but I'm just saying, you looked at their website, think of you as a startup that nobody knows. Would you get it from this site what they do?
And something about secure content, sure. So secure is the main.
Okay.
Content collaboration.
A lot of locks.
Which is called why. So I don't get from this site what they do, right? And not anymore. But I do get why. Security, security, security everywhere, right? And then we also saw who their customer is, enterprise. Let's go to Dropbox.com.
And they are collaborating with Microsoft too now.
Yeah.
So they are truly enterprise.
Everybody's looking for an elephant.
Keep going down. Who is their customer?
Individuals.
Consumers.
Okay. And what do they do?
Share photo.
Access from anywhere. Yeah.
Okay. What's the, why them? What's unique about them?
It's easy.
Ease of use. Agility.
Okay. Now you saw something that the marketing guy over there who just joined the company put there. Try Dropbox for Business. Do you think anybody will click that?
No.
No. This is called company getting confused. Not knowing who their customer is anymore because they want to get the revenue, so they're trying to focus on Dropbox for Business. They don't want to annoy their customer base, so they don't want to change the basic message, so they're confused. Previously, their website was the best ever. One simple thing with a little video. That's it. And it said everything. Now, new management, new marketing guy came in, who put in new messages, now it's all confused. Let's look at OneDrive. Okay, keep going down. What do you think this product does?
Tries to leverage Office to get Microsoft's
information. Who is it for?
Individuals.
It's for individuals, but after that they start to sell you the business aspect.
They want you to work from home.
Busy individuals.
So the reason I brought this up is you don't have that luxury of brand name recognition that you can continue to do these mistakes. So when you do your messaging right, you have to be very succinct in what you do. Let's do xcro.com.
Yeah.
We definitely have a slow website. Or we have a slow website. Why don't you do another tab while this is coming up? Let's do Zen.
I think that got started.
ZenPayroll.com.
It's
coming up. And then do an Airbnb. Okay. So what do they do?
Accounting for small business.
Why them?
They used to say beautiful accounting software. That's what they used to say. Before.
Yes, I know. But at least.
And that was nice.
But they have customer testimonials underneath. They say 5,000 reasons why our customers select. So you can click on it and then it gives you a whole long list. Let's go to the next one. Okay, forget that. Let's do an Airbnb, which may not come up because it's probably our website, our thing is very slow. Okay. So anyway, let's not go there. It's fine, Prashant. The reason I told you to go to Airbnb, it's probably one of the most beautiful websites you can go to. You can actually spend 10 minutes looking at that website just because they bring you those beautiful images in the back while the message is the same. Home, away from home or something.
Welcome home.
Welcome home. It used to be home away from home, now it is welcome home. But very, and they'll keep on changing these. No, you don't even need to go anywhere, right? This just says everything. And it just tells you, hey, there are all these beautiful places where you could be. That's all it does to catch you going. So that is the beauty of it. Now, one of the other things, when you will build your own websites, remember, there is something called above the fold and below the fold. This is above the fold right now. If your message does not come up above the fold, nobody is going to stay on your website. Be very clear. As a startup, you got 5 seconds, if that, before you will lose the customer. Only your competitors will stay. And you will feel like, oh, wow, so many people spend so much time. And then you will realize that your competitors who came in as consultants. So remember, if you didn't capture me in the first 5 seconds, you are going to lose me. So that is a very important point. Okay, with that, let me take a couple of questions. And then I'll have Vic join me here. And we will analyze his website. So Vic, you can get started and set up your website since it's going to take a long time to have a host resolution. Okay.
I have a question. When you talked about being very, very specific in your segment.
Yeah.
If you're not, let's say you have two.
I'll repeat the question so you don't need to worry about it.
If there are two different segments, they're related to how they make money, but they're two different segments in terms of the go-to-market and who they are. How do you quickly test which one is better? Like, because you say build it for them, but you know, you kind of want to know, like,
agreed,
which ones are going to stick with.
So the question is, I have two segments that are very, very close to each other. How do I know which one is really going to be my first segment to go after? And the rule is called money. Who do you think is most likely to pay for your product? Not just try it. Meaning, who really has such a pressing need that they will actually pay for it?
Which means you have to do kind of a sales motion to get in contact with
them. Absolutely.
So establish that.
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, if I didn't make it clear, don't sit in the room and expect that things will come to you. You gotta get out of your office and really find people to talk to. You all have networks, you know how to reach people, reach them in any possible way. Before you start a company, spend more time talking to people than doing anything else. Don't do a single line of code until and unless you have talked to 10 to 15 prospects. They're not customers yet. Until you've talked to them and, you know, tools exist, you can make your PowerPoint look like a presentation, which is like an app, wireframe it, go with the wireframe, get the feedback on wireframe if you think customer will not understand it. But again, don't let a customer design the product. You are still designing it. But try to understand the problem they have you can relate to. Okay? Any other questions?
You did mention like you need to figure out what not to do, right? Can you give some examples?
Can I give some examples of what not to do? So I think I was listening to Aaron Levy at Box. Maybe that's probably your best example. So he said, we went in and, you know, we were focusing on the end customer. We were trying to be another Dropbox. And they made a decision that that's not where they want to be. They want to be for business. So then they knew what they had to do for sure. And they probably knew what they can get away without doing it at that time. So they were not mobile in the beginning, if you remember. Dropbox was mobile day one. They were not. So they must have made a decision we could live without it for a while, as an example. Because they were focusing on the IT guy who felt secure in the files being shared in the cloud. So that could be an example. I'm sure if I think about it, I'll come up with more, but that's just one.
You just talked about the Dropbox case where they launched for consumers and trying to focus enterprise. I'm a bit confused, like, is it the right strategy? Because I have a case study with Zendesk, which launched for consumer and now they are leader in even enterprise segments too. So they moved the whole segment of stuff. So confusion is it okay to have a single brand for consumer and smaller customers? And a bigger enterprise Fortune customers, or you should have two different brands so that you handle differently because enterprise has a different message, consumer has a different message.
Okay. So the question is, you know, can you start, first question is, can you start in a small, consumer brand and then you can become enterprise? So the answer is yes. There used to be the initial way software development used to be done about 10 years ago is that you always build for the enterprise because that is where the most money was. And then if you were lucky and survived, you would probably then start to build, come lower down and start to build for SMBs. And if you survive that segment, then you will go into consumer. Microsoft is a classical example of that. That's how software used to be done. Now it's done reverse. You start with the end customer. You get the end customer excited about your product, and then you expect the end customer to go up within the organization, and you go make that change. So for example, what Box and Dropbox used to do I know Box did even until recently. So they used to give you 5 gigs of thing free, right? And they increased it at some time to 50 gigs. But you could only do that if it was an enterprise email address. So what they did afterwards is they went in and said, oh, I have, you know, whatever, McKinsey.com. I have 10 users of McKinsey.com, or I have 100 users of McKinsey.com. Now let me have a sales guy call the McKinsey IT guy and say, hey, I already got 50 users in your company who love this product. Wouldn't you want to buy it?
Yes.
And oh, by the way, I'll give you all the enterprise features that they don't have. So that worked, right? Now, Zendesk is a very different example. And I think the reason Zendesk succeeded from a consumer brand to becoming an enterprise brand is because Zendesk focused on developers. And most of the developers were doing early startups. And Zendesk was a cheaper way to for them to just, you know, get with the program, because it was one place where they could manage their customer interaction and their internal interaction and everything else. Now, it just so happens that many of those companies did well. As they did well, Zendesk continued to do well. Now, after that, they built an enterprise sales force and went after companies to convert. They didn't start that way. Now, the question of, should I keep two brand names? It's not your problem in this zone. You are in the 0 to 1 million zone. You have no problem of branding, okay? You don't have to worry about two brands. You can't handle one even. So don't worry about it yet. Those are very good problems to have. When the time comes, you'll find enough consultants who will advise you the right thing. Right? So don't worry about it today. Yeah? So what is the good way of reaching out? I think we have the next two sessions where we're going to focus on that quite a bit. So the next session is going to be on sales, how to do your initial sales, where to find them, what are the various ways people have succeeded, and so on. So I'll reserve it for that. And then the third section is going to deal with, okay, I have some initial customers. How do I now take that message and expand it everywhere, i.e. what marketing tools and other things I can use to expand the message, okay? I'll take one from each table. Anything else on this table, anybody? Okay?
How do you formulate, whom do you target your message to if you have a two-sided business? What I mean by two-sided business is like Groupon, you need both consumers as well as merchants, or even Dropbox, you need even Airbnb, you need people to register their homes as well as somebody to book. So in that way, how do you, even designing your website and everything becomes a little hard, like 5 seconds, whom do you deliver the message, whom to target, how do you decide?
So if you have two-sided, transaction to deal with, how do you target which segment to do? I don't know what is the right answer for each situation, but I was listening to a talk from the Uber CEO recently, and he focused a lot on saying, I want to make sure when you go somewhere, you have a cab available, or you have a car available. So therefore, we focused initially all of our efforts when we go to a market to actually get more cars signed up than the passengers. So, however, they have a lot of money. They actually give free money to people in the beginning to sign up. I was in India recently and, you know, I was told that both Uber and Ola Cab, the minimum ride is 200 rupees that you as a customer pay. But they actually pay you 200 on top to the driver. So they're losing 200 rupees per ride because they want to sign up more drivers. So if you want to do that kind of a business, you need to have some deep pockets to do that. Right? So PayPal did that before. if you read the PayPal story, they gave a lot of free money in the beginning. I don't know whether that is right or wrong. You have to know for your business, but that's how people have done it so far. There was another question there, yeah.
Paul, could you tell about your 5 startups? I just want to understand your background more from a B2B standpoint.
So my first 2 startups were in the internet security space. They were both in the B2B space. We ended up selling both of them. The third one was in the voice over IP switch for the operators. So our target customers were operators who were selling, you know, $1 million plus deals. We went public in 2007. And right now I'm running a company called Espresso Logic. In between, I also had a mobile software company called PixSense, where we were doing Instagram before its time, and we didn't succeed. We got a lot of users, but we couldn't make money. Okay.
Did you find that what was the problem that you failed? Because you couldn't sell?
I think that's topic for another long day, because there is a lot of things that happen in a company which makes you work sometimes, and sometimes it doesn't work, both internal and external.
Could you tell a little bit about how to work with beta customers, or is that again a topic that
you take? I'll tell you a little bit, but I think we'll cover some of it. So I think, you know, the question is, how do we deal with your beta customers? And I think red carpet is probably the best description I can give you. Roll the red carpet for them, because you want them to be a reference. But that doesn't mean give it away for free, forever. If the expectation is this is free, yeah, you know, free things only have so much value. Okay? And one of the things I like to do is, even if you're going to give somebody a heavy discount, show them the price. Meaning, I'd rather quote you a price of $10,000 a month and then show you 80% discount for being a good customer than to tell you my price is $2,000. You will respect the value much more in that case. Okay. Let me get Vic over here, since he's been waiting patiently. Can you get your website up, please? Okay, but don't show it yet. I just want you to come in here first.
All right,
let's give Vic a big welcome. So Vic, why don't you tell them a little bit about, you know, kind of your journey? Don't tell them much about the company yet.
Okay.
Just kind of your background a little bit.
All right, so that'll be tricky still. I'm a career developer, so I'm one of the beavers that sits down and builds, and then people come down and knock down the dam saying you shouldn't have built it. So, but I've been a career developer my whole life. I knew in high school that I wanted to develop. I used to pretend my dad's organ was a computer, because there was not that many computers in my country. So I've been a CTO at Vendio. That was the number one partner for eBay. I got sold to Alibaba. I've worked at NASA on mainframe database programming. I worked at Akamai on video streaming, the China Olympics, and World Cup South Africa on real-time streaming. I wrote the first book on something called Struts. If there's any Java developers in here. Yeah, so the first book on Struts was written by me. But in general, a career developer, some 20 years in tech leadership.
Even though he said he's a developer, he's being modest, he's actually a very smart businessman. And most developers really are in their heart when they put their mind to it. I mean, Bill Gates is the classical example of the nerd who is actually the smartest businessman around. So before we tell Vic to talk anything about his company, what I want to do is I want to show you his website. And I'm going to ask some of you, what do you think the company does and so on. So go for it.
Mike.
Okay.
You're putting it in the laundry.
Can you go over?
Font is missing. Font is still missing.
I just want everybody to absorb it. Okay, can you go up again? Just stay above the four this time. That's it. Okay, who will tell me what do they do?
Actually, yep. Even if you go up before to the website, the Google thing says it makes your mobile apps 10x faster.
Okay, but that one doesn't say here, is it?
That's just before you, when you do a search on...
No, no, but I'm saying if you read the website, what do you see? I'm just doing the 5-second test. You've done the other homework, so I just want to know, what does the 5-second test tell you? What does it say?
Since I know them, that's how I know, but website doesn't say the same thing.
Okay.
You're using the...
So I'll ask all the people who already know what they do, what do they think they do? But people who don't know what they do, I want you to know who saw this website for the first time, what do you think?
API is much faster.
Okay.
So they supercharge your API.
Okay.
I thought it tells you where your API requests are coming from or something like that. Traffic shaping.
They save you from losing your customer because of bad quality of mobile apps.
Where does it say that?
It's APIs, REST APIs.
Okay, so you concluded the message on your own, but that's not what it says. I want to say what you walked away with in 5 seconds.
Nothing.
It's a strong engineering team. That's actually the API on the edge.
Something mobile for enterprise companies, like big companies like IBM.
It likes a lot of words.
It's for technical people.
No. Yeah.
It's too much text.
Too much text, okay?
All engineers can understand, I guess. Nobody.
I couldn't read the website and Apakau.
Yeah, it needs a bigger font.
It's the response time.
It's the response time.
Yeah.
Okay?
I look at security and the speed. So
I think you're all trying to be nice to him. He's my guest. I'm not going to be nice to him. His website doesn't say what he does.
Yeah,
above the fold, it doesn't tell me anything.
Sounds like a middleware or some edge solution.
Looks like
I don't know. I won't read it.
I think the main sentence is at the very end. It's in bold. It's make your API calls 10x faster.
Yeah, he should put a.
Okay. Now, people who said they know what he does, I'm going to ask you. What do you think he does?
He make my API's response faster. And better for my consumers.
Okay. Anyone else who said they know what the company does? So you said you read something on Google.
Yeah, it just said makes API 10 times faster. Yeah. And there's also on the website, if you go bottom.
It's there at the bottom of the page.
Bold.
Okay, so I'm going to have you talk in a few minutes, but let's hear the feedback, if that's useful, right?
Yeah, for sure. Appreciate it.
Okay. Who do you think is your customer?
Engineers.
Developers.
This, or anyone at this table?
Developers.
No company that
API
you.
API developers.
API developers.
Those are the users.
The company product that you that they have an API product for other companies.
Okay.
CTO.
Well.
CTO.
CTOs. How did you conclude CTO? Because he's a CTO? No. Yes, anyone else?
IT.
Why do you say it is IT?
Because it's a monitoring API, so somebody that wants to monitor all the APIs.
Okay.
Startup companies exposing their products via APIs.
Startup companies, okay.
I think it's something related to the network.
Something related to the network, okay.
The UX guy.
A UX guy, okay. Why them? What is their differentiation?
They are the geeks.
They're the geeks. So as a geek, would you read it? No, because look, one thing is very clear. that sometimes if you know your customer, because many developers, contrary to popular opinion, don't like things that are simple because it threatens their job. They like things complex. They like things that are difficult to use, that are painful. That's why there are so many languages that exist, right? Because they don't like it simple. I mean, Angular, probably not that wow, if you think about the grand scheme of things. It's not an easy language for somebody who is already trained. It's good for someone who has never programmed, but not necessarily for someone who is very experienced Java programmer.
Well, take out the fluff and give, you know, get to the point, right? That's kind of what he seems to be doing.
Okay. So, with that, I'm going to hand it off to you. And now you're going to tell us, what do you think you do, and what's your value add, and who do you target?
So I'll start off with the easiest one, which is who we target is. We only target CTOs and CIOs who, in my mind, are seasoned technical executives. They have a decade of doing technical stuff.
And what size companies?
So large companies, companies that are already using a CDN. Only 50% of companies are currently using a CDN, serving the traffic off the edge. And if you're not familiar or you don't know how to leverage the economies of edge economics, of how much cheaper that is, how much safer that is, how it prevents DDoS, as a small company, I don't have time to educate you. So I want you to be a CDN customer already. I want you to be an enterprise, and I want you to be an executive. And as an executive, presumably, you have a decade of technical experience. So that's from who I'm targeting.
So why don't you call yourself CDN for APIs?
Because, and so this is very, very important. So so one of the most important things that I think I do as a CEO is target the messaging. So if I say, and so the, so we have really good advisors, some world-class marketing people who have ownership in the company and who advise me, people that have written books and presented at the TiE conference and some of the largest conferences and have invested in large companies. So their advice, which I did not take, and I'll explain why I didn't take it, was to just put a tagline on, we make APIs 10 times faster. And I used to say that on my business cards. The problem with that is that it's a, I then as a company have verbal equivalence with all the other companies that say, I make things faster too. Cloudflare makes things faster. Fastly makes things faster. Instant Logic makes things faster. API, APG makes things 10 times faster. And now I fall into this defensive mode, is, well, why can't the CDN do this, right? Well, the answer, technical answer that I don't want to get into the discussion is that they cache things. Well, caching things, it's trivial to make things faster, but how do you make things 10 times faster without caching them? So I wanted to turn the message into a two-step message, right? Of saying, hey, the reason we're different is this, here's what we do. So instead of being defensive, I am the subject matter expert, talking to them as a sales engineer and educating them on it. So my tagline is traffic shaping of your REST and mobile APIs. Why? Because we make things 10 times faster. The opposite message, and I'm not saying this is good, I feel I have credibility as a CTO in Silicon Valley that I can get a job like that, you know, outside of my own company. But I'm not a marketing expert, and one of the things we're doing, the way I'm supplementing that is by hiring an executive that's got 20 years of marketing to join the executive team, to join the founding team. But if I flip the message the other way, if I say, hey, we're 10 times faster, now even consumers understand what we do. But I don't care if consumers understand, right? I want to be different. So one of the things, as a CTO, when I go to sell, I don't want to be the first. I'm not the first sales guy that they have seen. They've seen lots of salespeople. So I want to get immediately into how we're different. What are the metrics? I want to get into those kinds of things, right? One of the things I hated as a CTO is going to a vendor's website and seeing racially diverse people smiling. And now I have to wonder, what does this product even do? Right, so I want to be, if you think of Venn diagrams, and again, somebody says I'm an engineer. If you look at the Venn diagrams, I don't want to focus on what they have and what's in common. I want to focus on how am I different. and my product is uniquely different because we uniquely focus on the APIs, we uniquely turn them off the API, off the edge, and we're able to prioritize them. We're able to make some APIs faster and slower for whatever the business benefit of that is, so that the end, so that the customer concludes, oh, this is a good product, or oh, this makes me fast. So hopefully I didn't overthink that.
So I think I think your API latency without Apakau captures it in some sense. But I think generally when I come to a website, that go of a startup's website, I'm not interested in your story right away. You have to earn my trust before I read your story. That's my only comment to you. You're telling me your story too early in the cycle. You have not focused on me, i.e. customer. You're focusing on you. And I want to you to focus on me as a customer,
yep.
Not on you. You should be at the bottom where I can click if I'm interested, but not in the front. Okay? All right, so thank you for being a good sport, but
hold on.
So I think, you know, you want to tell them in terms of how you ended up developing your product and how you came up with the idea, how did you actually change the idea along the way, and why is your idea what it looks like today?
Yeah, so there's an important story coming up in here. So the way I came up with the idea is that some 2+ years ago, I was in a career decision point. Do I get a highly paid executive job and do nothing, or do I do a startup? I didn't know what to do, so I said, hey, I'll write another book. And if the book was gonna be best practices. So the first chapter of the best book has to be mobile first, because 2 years ago that was the hottest thing, so it was mobile first. Because I worked at Akamai on real-time video streaming, what struck me immediately was like, APIs are not being served off the edge. Images are, assets are, other things are. So it was obvious to me, it's like, hey, you know what? APIs must be served off the edge mathematically because of Amdahl's law and because of lots of other reasons. And at that point, I decided, because I didn't make any money on the first book, not to teach people how to fish, but to feed them the fish. So that's how the company got started. I spent 9 months doing the prototype. And my initial market was to go after developers. And at that time, I ran into a seasoned executive who was not as one-dimensional in their career as myself, being purely technical and technical leadership side, who said, you know what? If you sell to executives, they have budgets. And we pivoted away from developers and into corporations. So that was a major pivot. We had to rebrand the company. It used to be called Primus APIs. And we had to change the name brand because we already had customers. We had already people paying us. We had developer base when we pivoted away from existing customers into selling to executives. What was the other question?
So how do you make that transition? Do you dump those customers? Do you, still continue servicing them? What do you do?
We basically dumped them. We gave them, 45-day notice saying, hey, we'll continue, our servers are gonna keep running, but we're going to deprecate it. Here's some customers you can go to. We were gonna stick with the company name, but every time we would talk to somebody, they would say, oh, you guys are a tool for developers. And so we had to change the name of the company. We had to go to the lawyers and have the DBA changed because the shares were already issued, the cap table was already issued, and this kind of stuff. So we have this funny certificate where, if investors do due diligence, we have to show them, the company that incorporated is not the company Apakau.
That's just a brand name you bought, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. Are there questions from the audience for you first?
How's your message resonating?
So, I think you guys were kind. I definitely think that there's areas for improvement on the website. What I find is that because I'm the one that does most of talking to the customers today, is when I do it, one, two, it goes a lot better empirically. When I flip it, because my business card used to say 10 times faster, and I threw away all those cards because they kept saying, fastly says the same thing. They're faster. Twin Prime says the same thing. We're faster. So I had to flip the message to talk about, in the Venn diagram, how am I different, and then go into the benefit in a two-step, you know, in like in soccer you have two kicks, or in a boxing you have one, two. So it's a two-part message. It sets up the right thing. So empirically, obviously, I like the message. I mean, there's things we can improve on here. But I definitely want to be, you know, A, having a technical background, I definitely want to be having a technical message, or as I would call scientific message, right? You know, because I don't want to have a faith-based product where, well, I believe this is faster. I don't care if you believe or not believe. Scientifically, I can show you this is 10 times faster.
When I was a performance engineer, I'm always looking at latency as graphs. Why is that not a graph, as opposed to tables of numbers?
So it used to be a graph, and it was a really good message. But if you only look at one thing about our company, you want to say that images are getting served fast and APIs are being served slow. So we may go back to the graphs. Most of the time, it's a good point. We haven't done the A/B testing, obviously. And the other thing I want you everybody to understand is I'm very comfortable being a seed stage company. I'm not an A stage company, so I'm okay being sort of an infant that can crawl, that can't walk, that can't run yet. So I'm comfortable at the stage of the company where I'm at. So I'm not sure that that is actually a better, whether a chart is better or a developer browser thing is better.
So are most of your customers visiting the website after you talk to them, as opposed to they come to the website and then talk to you?
Both. So
percentage-wise?
We don't have those metrics, but I can tell you that based on our blog posts and tweets, customers have found it and come to talk to us.
But blogs, to me, is almost going up. Right? You have a particular message of going out that clicks with them, and
right,
they come to the website. So my question is, you know, do you have enough web traffic coming on its own without those blogs and stuff where somebody comes into your site and then he or she stays for a while?
I don't know the answer to that, but I can talk around the question you've asked. And one of them is that I don't care how many consumers like my website. They're not my target audience, right? I'm not targeting consumers, so if you come in here and you are not my target audience, and
I want you
it doesn't, you may have an opinion, I don't want it to be an angry one, but I don't need it to be a positive one. So I don't know if that talks
okay
to that.
Good. Okay, one last question for me. Anybody over there? Yeah.
Yeah, so is it a kind of a sales technique where you tell the scientific message and let a smart executive figure out the rest of the story, or because as the presentation at the beginning of the evening went that, okay, you know, there has to be a punchline or a message where the images keep scrolling in the background. So is there a reason you went with the pure scientific message?
Yes.
Highly descriptive one.
Yes. I mean, if I could, I would do ASCII graphics. Does anybody know what the ASCII graphics are? I want to be different. I want to be different in a crowded market. I am anticipating being successful. So all, by the way, this is a thesis. We are a stage company. The things that I'm trying and the things I'm being told are different. So this company may succeed or may not succeed based on what I'm trying. So this is not something for you guys to say, oh, this Vic's doing that and he's successful. I'm not successful. I'm at a seed stage. I'm comfortable doing that. I want to have it be technical, right? I want to talk about competitors, because in marketing they tell you not to talk about competitors. Have you ever guys gone to the open source projects and they're kind of really ugly pages, the ASCII arts, and then they list all the competing projects, right? I want to be able to do that as much as possible. I want to test how far I can go in that direction and have that kind of credibility when I talk to the customers, showing them the metrics, showing them here's the repeatable, here's a third-party site you can do. You can run JMeter against this. So that is a thesis. I'm not saying that it's going to be a successful one. You had another question that you
wanted? Yeah, it's a of the same question.
So I think I want to make sure that there is the message is communicated properly. That you design your message based on who your target customer is. He's decided his target customer, and he says he knows his target customer. That's what his target customer is looking for. He wants his target customer initially to be the guy who is very technical, who really is looking for speeds and feeds or whatever the data he's providing to them. So it makes sense. Now, Airbnb was a message I gave you a beautiful site because you and I are, everyone is our focus, right? So, and plus, they want to entice you to go to places. So therefore, they entice you by showing you other places, so it makes a lot of sense. Now, you know, you go to an enterprise B2B website, they're very boring. Why? Because that's their target customer, right? I mean, so the point is you have to figure out what works for your target customer. You don't have to be cute just because it's supposed to be cute. You have to see where it fits in with your target audience, okay? Next slide, please. Next one. This is going to be our next week's topic. I hope you're not doing this. And if people can read in the back, it basically says, how much longer do we have to wait until a customer finds us, walks into this meeting room, and places a big order?
Long time.
So if any of you are doing that, you know, change your tune. Okay? I'll take a couple of questions and then we're done, if there are any. Any burning questions, I'll take now. No? Going once? Going twice? All right. See you guys next week.